Yeah, go ahead.
Okay,
I'm actually
great.
On record, so.
Yeah, that was good. I was going to ask if you were recording.
Yep, go ahead and go ahead.
All right, I'm going to share my screen here. And while I'm doing that. Oh, Eric, I have.
Right now.
Here we go. So hopefully you'll see a title slide. All right. Well, thank you. And my presentation today is on a method of doing some virtual operations that the Los Angeles Model Railroad Society does. We do these on a monthly basis, usually on a Sunday. And we've stumbled our way through probably about 10 or 11 of these, maybe a few more. And so today I'm going to present what our take is on virtual operations. So with that, I'm going to jump right in. So I'd like to welcome you to the Western Consolidated Railroad Company. We were formed through the acquisition of several Class 1 routes in the Western United States. And we began as a way to compete against other railroads. So getting you from the harbor to the city, from the desert to the mountains is our slogan. We connect lumber, oil, natural resources from the mountains of Colorado all the way to California and to the city centers of Colton, Gardena, and ultimately to the Pacific Harbor. We've recently added reefer car service, and we have the ability to transport frozen goods and cold storage. Our motto, no matter where you are, we can get there, shows how diverse our reach is. Freight may pay the bills, but connecting people is what makes us happy. We proudly offer passenger service. So we saw a need in railroad traffic. And so the Los Angeles Model Railroad Society, or LAMRS, we used to have monthly operating sessions before the pandemic. They varied by era and theme, such as transition era to modern TT and TO, CTC. We have narrow gauge, lumber logging, industrial ops. We have a really fun variety of things there. And also some of our members have layouts of our own, myself and a few of the members who are on the Zoom today. The members' layouts vary from standard gauge to narrow gauge, from HO to N scale. We have one layout that has HO inside and connects to a G scale garden railroad. Our layouts vary in size. So our club layouts, a little over 2,000 square feet. An individual member, one of the individual private layouts, is about 1,500 square feet, all the way down to door size layouts. And so obviously, with the pandemic, we couldn't operate the club anymore and together. So we were challenged to come up with a way to keep members active, keep people connected, and we went through all the learning cycles that I think all of us have gone through, learning how to use Zoom and various technologies. So we considered remote controlled operations for a little bit, using JMRI remotely. We have a number of people whose layouts have that. Our club layout actually uses Railroad and Company. But I think that quickly became obvious that the technical level of our members varies a lot. And so being able to pull that off without physically being able to go someplace and help someone set up wasn't really going to be a possibility. But one of our layouts, as I was saying, has an operation scheme where he passes an HO train and ends at his HO layout. And the train picks up in his G scale layout and then continues to run. And we took that idea and through a few brainstorming sessions developed our operating scheme. So that's where the Western Consolidated Railroad Company came to life. So just a quick overview, it's a pass the baton type operations. It passes from one layout to the next, the running of a train. Each person operates their own layout. So for those who have their own layout, you're the only operator on it. Each layout is organized to reflect a point-to-point scheme. Regardless of how they've actually set up their layouts, a start point was designated and an end point was designated. One was called west and one end called east. That's really was up to the layout owner as to how they wanted to define that. Some layouts, mine included, is a switching layout without a lot of mainline. So to integrate those kinds of layouts, we identified on different layouts an interchange track. And so interchange traffic would occur between the mainline type layouts where you could have more long mainline running and the switching layouts. And so we strung them together to create one system. Prior to a virtual operating session, operators will stage a train or several trains on their layouts. Certain cars for interchange may be staged as well. And some of that is also done. Not every train is staged. Some of it is the operator's role in the early part of the session is to build a train or to add cars for set outs and so forth. So there's a little bit of variability between what you can have pre-staged or what you want pre-staged versus what you'll do as a switching activity on your own layout. All right, so as we strung them together, this was our high level schematic. So the Oakhurst Railroad starts on the west point, the west end of the line, goes to Colton. The AEWRR, the Western Terminal Railroad. My layout is the PHL, and then we have another small switching layout called the Gardena Short Line. So this is how we strung them together. We also note on here that certain items are passenger and freight. And so the idea is some of the layouts that have more run capability or more mainline capability would run the passengers trains through them, where the rest of us just passed freight cars. All right, so the idea is a train starts on one layout with a particular manifest and moves across that person's layout in a point-to-point fashion. At the end of the layout, they'll contact the dispatcher and a handoff will occur where the trains are picked up and that train and that manifest is picked up on the next layout. So that's why we call it a pass the baton operating model. It'll run through the next layout and then hand off again until the train ultimately terminates. We use a timetable, and the timetable allows a train to start or terminate on any layout. And within a given layout, an operator can run any local trains that they want to do using whatever method or system they want to use. So several of the layouts will have extras. Maybe the operator will serve as the yard master in that case. The train manifest, though, for the freight train that goes from layout to layout is determined by a switch list that we put together prior to an operating session. So as we developed this scheme and over time, we started to realize that we needed different roles to keep things working smoothly. Obviously, if you're going to do timetable, it's easiest with the train master. And when you have multiple people who are connecting in from their own layouts, somebody has to be there to coordinate the activity of the train. So the dispatcher train master is a key role. We also realized that juggling Zoom and trying to manage your own layout and trying to keep track of a timetable is a lot of hats for someone to wear. So we eventually were able to bring someone from the club in as the Zoom director. And that person is really the MC of the event from a Zoom perspective. So whether it's spotlighting a camera, spotlighting a layout, helping to provide some narration for any of those who are observing, this role added a lot of color and organization. It looks like a stream of consciousness Zoom meeting if you're just jumping in. So this role really helped to smooth that out. Obviously, we have the layout operators doing all the staging, running, switching, and coordinating, and communicating with the dispatcher. We've kicked around the idea of a freight clerk, and the idea of maybe adding a little bit more complexity of switching trains and cars through the different layouts, though We have not implemented that yet, but it's something we have explored a little bit. All right, so here is the timetable that we operate under. And the red arrow shows extra 34 East freight. And this is one that I have a little bit of video that I'll show, and we can see how a train moves from one layout to the next. So this one here starts on the Oakhurst Railroad. So that's the 10 o'clock a.m. is when we start the session. We use a real one-to-one clock. We start at 10. We try to stick with that. What we found, though, is that there's variances in time between people's watches. So one of our members was able to create a macro into the timetable that shows the system time. So this 10 o'clock a.m. at the top, actually, the dispatcher will launch that and starts the time. The dispatcher also has this timetable. This timetable sits on their computer, and this is a shared screen that's available throughout the session. So it's always up there on the left side for everyone to go and see. And so we operate this way. In the beginning, we highlighted this in yellow. As we progressed, what we've moved to most recently is started to enter in the actual times that a train will OS to the dispatcher. So the train will move. This one that we're going to watch in a little bit will be train extra 34 East. We'll start at camp 4, wind through. It actually starts outside on Marty's G scale Garden Railroad. And I believe it's either camp 3 or Oakhurst. I don't remember which. It actually moves to HO scale indoors and will then proceed through his layout. Once he reaches Fresno, we will hear Marty OS to the dispatcher saying that the train has arrived at Fresno, in which case the dispatcher will then notify Ira on the Colton Railroad that the train has actually arrived now at the engine ready track. And the train will then proceed through Ira's layout all the way through to and continuing on down to the AEWRR, and will ultimately terminate at Indian Wells. Depending on how much time we have and whether I've kept people interested or not, I also have the ability to show a video of the extra 36 East reefer and having it turn around and become the 43 West reefer. So we have some things to look at there if we'd like. If people have questions or want to jump in, if you have the ability to unmute and do that, that's great. If you want to wait to the end.
Yeah, okay. It's probably easier for you if we keep the questions in the chat.
Okay.
There are some questions along the way, but I don't want to interrupt you. So.
Yeah, and I don't, with the amount of screen real estate, I don't see the chat. So Eric, if you see somebody who's chat and wants to jump in, I'm okay either way.
Why don't you just go ahead and continue, and then we'll do the questions at the end.
Perfect. Okay. So moving on then, here is our switch list. So trains before the operating session will be staged for certain spots along the way here. So for Oakhurst, there'll be a train with a makeup of particular cars that is set and ready to go. So at 10 o'clock, that train will begin its run. As it goes and it can stop at a yard, it may pick up cars and drop off cars. So on the right side here, you can see what would ultimately be added to the manifest and what would be dropped. And so at the end of this, we know that as the train goes from the Oakhurst Railroad to the Colton Railroad, we can see what the manifest is going to look like. And so in this case, the Colton Railroad will have that train with that manifest staged and ready to go. What Marty will do as part of his operations and running the train from the beginning of his layout to the end will be to do the various switching at various industries to make up that manifest. And so this creates a little bit of variety, and it gives some purpose to the Oakhurst Railroad to get some cars set up. Now, this depends a little bit on timing and whether he has time to do that. So we've had a little bit of learning of how many cars can people switch before the freight is scheduled to arrive on their layout. So this has been through some iterations, and so that's our switch list. All right, so getting into the weeds a little bit, just to show, as we see the video, you'll see the train will start on camp 4, proceed to middle camp 6, middle camp, and then camp 3. This is where it will transfer to HO, fish camp, all the way up to Oakhurst. After Oakhurst, it will then proceed to Fresno. This is a view of the Oakhurst Railroad. You will start up here on the top, upper layer, go in a counterclockwise fashion. It goes down the helix, if I remember correctly. We'll come back out, winds through the layout here at the bottom layer, and ultimately we'll end up at Oakhurst here for a yard. We'll catch a little bit of switching action there, and then from there we'll proceed on to Fresno and off of the Oakhurst Railroad. This is the Colton Railroad. This is an N-scale door layout. So one of the challenges, obviously, is it's a fairly small amount of real estate, so it doesn't take a lot of time to go around. I believe Ira put in a twice around model to add a little bit of mainline running. He'll start at the smaller AD track here at the bottom, proceed counterclockwise through Aventura Station, and then ultimately ends up, after going around, we'll end up at the engine ready down the bottom left corner of the screen. This is the AEWRR. If any of you know Ron, this is his layout, Ron Varnell. He will start at Mesa Grande, wind through his layout, and ultimately ends up at Indian Wells. So here's a view of his layout. This is about a 1,500 square foot layout. So it gives you an idea of the types of layouts that we have connected together, everything from a small door layout to a nice room size HO, G scale, to a very large private layout. All right, with that, I'm going to jump into the video.
You're going to have to turn the audio up there, Michael.
So was that Eric?
Yeah, the audio is, I can't hear it. So if there's audio there, you're going to have to crank the volume up.
Uh-huh. All right, let me see what I can do here. That sounds like a Zoom thing. So
yeah, stop your share.
Okay.
When you do the share, there's a special option to share the, let me find it here. So when you pick the thing to share down at the bottom, there's a share computer sound and optimize screen sharing for video clip. I would check both of those.
Yes, thank you.
We'll see if that works better.
Okay, let me, someone else is sharing right now.
Yeah, I don't know who Ray Turner is, but he needs to stop sharing. Right now.
All right, let's see here. All right, let's try that again. All right. Did we get sound that time?
Not yet.
All right, I'll try it one more time here. Sorry, did we get sound that time?
Mm-mm.
All right, let me try it this way then. Let me pop out of PowerPoint and just go right to the video then. I think that might be easier. So let me hit stop share here for a moment.
No, hold on. Apparently video optimization is not the best. Okay, so don't just turn the computer audio on, not the video optimization.
Okay, share sound. All right, here we go. We'll try it one more time.
There we go.
There we go. We got some background music here.
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry, I clicked off of it and that. All right. There we go.
Dispatcher, this is Oakhurst.
Oakhurst dispatch.
Extra 34 East is departing Camp 4.
Dispatch copy.
Okay, here we have Camp 4 on the Oakhurst Railroad. A logging camp going up to, see, we get a shot here and we can see what we're doing. Okay, here's our first train.
Dispatch. Refrigerator train, extra 34 East, ready to depart Aventura for the A to D track.
Okay, that's 38 East.
38 East, the reefer train.
And here's the reefer train.
Dispatcher, this is Oakhurst.
Oakhurst dispatch.
So let me just jump in. So other trains are running in the background, so we're going to follow 34 East, but you're going to hear some of the background radio traffic for some of the other ones. So you also hear a couple numbers get mixed up a little along the way. They do correct themselves, but just so you guys remember, we're trying to follow 34 East. So if you hear another railroad or another train being communicating, that's just background traffic.
So 34 East has arrived at Camp 3.
Dispatch copy.
Here is the extra 34 East. You've got a tank car, a flat car, and a box car probably coming down. This is from the Yosemite area. Coming down for supplies probably to bring back up to the camps. This is an outdoor G scale layout, and this is indoor. Leaving Camp 4, it's going into a tunnel. It's going to go down a winding, it's actually hidden, but it's a helix of several lines. It winds down to the bottom level. The 34 East coming out of this tunnel.
Every time I hear a whistle whine from a lonesome locomotive coming down the line, it carries my mind away to another place and time, when train traveling across the land was the only way to fly. Am I a fool to think it glamorous? Boxcarring like a hobo, it must have been rough, but a simpler way of life is what it really means to me.
Dispatcher, this is Oakhurst.
Oakhurst, dispatch.
Extra 34 East has arrived in Oakhurst.
But you can see the... you can see the town right here and even the electrical wires. It adds to the realism of this and the scenery. Of course, this is a yard, and in the corner there, there's a roundhouse.
Dispatcher, this is Oakhurst.
Oakhurst dispatch.
Extra 34 East is departing Oakhurst.
Copy.
Okay. We're seeing 34 East leaving Oakhurst now. Looks like it's bringing back supplies to the logging camps. They've filled back up with what they need, probably food, water, tools, maybe oil, kerosene.
Dispatcher, this is Oakhurst.
Oakhurst dispatch.
Extra 34 East has arrived in Fresno.
Dispatch copy.
We weren't so dependent on money to be free. I hear you, train, are you traveling my way?
Colton Dispatch.
This is Colton Dispatch.
Colton, Extra 34 East has arrived at engine ready.
Thank you. I'll start working on it in about 5 minutes. I'm pulling some cars for it.
That's fine.
So there's an example of Ira is working on the switch list to build the set of cars for that train to pick up. So he's going to take the manifest that came to him from Marty, add then take away the cars, and then he will run that through his layout, ultimately transferring to the next layout. So we'll pick up the action again.
Okay, here's switching out the Colton.
Dispatch, this is Colton.
Colton, dispatch.
Extra 34 East freight has arrived at A to D track, and I've completed.
Where are you going? That.
Dispatch, copy. AWR, dispatch.
So before I jump there, we didn't get any video of it going around his layout, but he did go all the way around. And so as he's completed that, now he's ready to hand off to the next layout.
Go ahead, dispatch.
AWR, train number 34 East is at Mason Grande.
Thank you. AEWRR to dispatch.
AEWRR to dispatch.
Train number 34 East is departing Wickenburg.
Dispatch, copy.
AEWRR to dispatch. Extra
AEWRR to dispatch.
At Indian Wells. It's off the railroad.
What's at Indian Wells?
34 East has arrived at Indian Wells.
Thank you.
Won't you let me ride your rails right back to yesterday? Who knows what I could see from.
All right. So what we saw there was 34 East proceeding through all the different layouts. And the last one there was Ron's. Unfortunately for that day, his camera wasn't working, or he has several cameras. But the kind of the nice thing about our system is really the cameras are there for anybody who's watching. But to operate, as long as we have the dispatcher, we know where the train is, and we can track the timing as well. All right. So some of the layouts. Like mine, for example, don't have really any mainline running. So what we developed was a way to pass cars back and forth through the interchange. And so we designate on my layout, I have a siding. And it, as my layout is in the process of being built, sometimes that changes from one session to the next, but it's always designated. So I have an interchange track with the Western Terminal Railroad. And we've gone through kind of different methods. We played around with some switch lists, and one of the systems we did is the car order system, where it's a waybill system that really is based on car type rather than a specific car or car number. And this worked well for passing cars because obviously the Western term, well, not obvious to you, but the Western Terminal Railroad is in a different era. Mine's a modern era. The Western Terminal Railroad is an older railroad. So I don't have any cars on my layout that would be a reefer that would require icing, for example, and he wouldn't have any corn syrup tank cars. So the way we get around that is we just use a car type to switch between us. he would have a tank car, I'd have a tank car, and I have a car that would be set in staging in a box. And so when Lloyd calls the PHL yard master and says, I've dropped off a tank car for you, he would read off the card and say that this is a car that is destined for Cargill syrups. I would then pull that car out of a box, put it onto the interchange track, and put the car order with that. And then I would switch my layout based on that car order. So my next freight that goes past that interchange track would pick it up. And ultimately then I know where to switch it. So we each have a copy of each other's card for the cars that were in industries that we're going to interchange with. This can be as complicated or as simple as you like. It can just be someone just calling in and saying, hey, I dropped a car off. And whether they did it on their layout or not is, you know, is doesn't really matter. But I don't necessarily know before a session exactly which cars I'm going to get. And that creates a little bit of variability. So as I'm working on my layout, all of a sudden, maybe it's a covered hopper that shows up, or it's a bulkhead flat car. And so that's going to go to a different industry. And so when he decides what he's going to drop off for me, I may not know, and that creates more interest on the layout. And then I can pass cars to him. We actually have a scheme where a car can be passed from the Western Terminal Railroad to the PHL, and then I carry that car to the next interchange track and pass that through to the Gardena short line. So it's a fun way to connect three different switching layouts together. Just real quick, the car movements on a switching and using the car order system. You kind of see how it moves back and forth. So then the reefer in this case is going on to the interchange track. The paperwork is moving through. Now the car is there on the interchange. It becomes a pickup on the bottom here on the Western Terminal. I then have a car that's sitting there, and I can flip that car over and pretend that that car now that I theoretically dropped off for interchange is now something that I have to pick up and bring through my system. So I bring it back to my yard, and the car card cycle through. Meanwhile, Lloyd on the Western Terminal will pull that car to his yard, and then we'll route it to the appropriate industry on his as a set out. So there's some stuff out there on the car order system. It's just nice because it's based on car type rather than being in specific. All right, so the next section I wanted to go through is just share some of the lessons learned that we've had and in developing the scheme. So one is the length of a layout and being able to run around a couple times to extend that timeline to give a little bit of more operational enjoyment out of it. Switching layouts. I did passenger on one of our first ones, but it took all of 2 minutes to go 20 feet on my layout, and that didn't seem very interesting. So that's where we started to come up with different ways to pass cars around. I had heard a presentation on the car order system, I think through one of these Zoom meetings, and thought, gee, you know, that might be applicable to exchange cars between virtual layouts, you know, virtually between two layouts. So, the Western Terminal started as a standard gauge. Now it's predominantly narrow gauge layout. So we've had people who've changed their layouts in their schemes, but it doesn't really matter because you can plug or unplug a layout, and just rather than you can either allow for it between when the dispatcher says, hey, it's arrived, and when it's left a layout, you can skip a layout. So it becomes very plug and play the way we do this, because there's no physical exchange. It's just what you communicate to the dispatcher. The AEWRR is big enough that, you know, a couple people can work it, and it works better with a couple people. So that has been a little bit of a challenge. I've been trying to create a group of people that can safely operate and be socially distanced. So, like, I know he's had some people who've worked the computer who actually are under a tent outside. So, whereas one or two people might be inside. So it's, that was something that he's had to work out as well. Communication is always a challenge, and Zoom for what it is good for a tool to try to run a virtual operating session between it. You know, you quickly max out its capabilities. Zoom has developed some new stuff along the way that has helped to smooth that. But, you know, it's not intended for this. There's probably were other tools that were out there that would have been better, but this was one that was free. It was easy to use, and, you know, it was fairly small learning curve. But we continue to struggle with getting through all the Zoom nuances. But I think we've gotten to a point now where we're you know, we got the dispatcher to share his screen, and, you know, there's just getting the screen to be visible, to have, you know, the side-by-side views and the little settings in Zoom. We've been able to do that pretty effectively, and I think it's working well for us now. So the interchange, we talked about the car order system. And the nice thing about Zoom is if you're in between activities on your layout, it is fun to go and watch and try to catch, you know, the train left my layout, it's now moving on the next one, and to see how that's progressed. We did a Christmas run, and we usually do a Christmas open house at the club where we run Christmas trains around the layout, and kids can come in and run the trains. Obviously, we couldn't do that this year, so we did a Christmas run, and everybody ran the extra Christmas train, and whatever your train was, you got to run it and showcase it as it went from one end of the layout to the next. So it is fun. We've had a lot of people who've added cameras to the layout. Marty has a few cameras, Ron has several. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to get the footage, but Ron actually has a couple of Raspberry Pi that have been used to drive camera cars. And so he can actually stream from the front in front of a locomotive. And so you can actually catch a cab level view as his train is moving through the layout. So that's fun. We use OBS. If we get to some of the other footage, you'll see a little bit of OBS come in where we can have two cameras on the same screen. The other challenge, obviously, with all this is some people are using laptops, some use Macs, some use tablets, and that's always a fun trying to manage all the different types of technology. We also quickly learned that there's really a very, very much a limit into how many hats an operator can work. So if you're at home working on your layout by yourself, to run the cameras, to run the trains, to do switching, to have more than one train on a layout and trying to do a meet, it's really tricky. So we've had to really pare down the volume of traffic just to get all the other things worked out. And then as we've gotten more comfortable with the tools and technology, we started to add more trains and making it a little bit more complex. So starting off simple was definitely improvement, definitely the way to go. And so that's our continuous improvement. Obviously, as everybody knows, if it can go wrong, it will. And given the amount of pieces of technology just to pull this off, you know, cameras stop working, batteries die, you know, we've had everything. So, but that's okay. You know, we've been able to work through it. So when a layout goes down, we just keep, we can bypass it and make those changes. So it's pretty flexible. I think we talked about a lot of this. So the last thing here is kind of an interesting byproduct, since all of a sudden everyone's home layouts are now on the screen for everyone else to see. And since everybody's using their layouts for an op session once a month, it's amazing how our layouts at home have gotten a lot better. So I start off with 19, 20 feet of layout. Then I added a staging yard, and now I've added my actual yard all during this time. So one person tore out a bunch of his standard gauge and added a whole bunch more narrow gauge, and just a lot of tweaks and getting things running. So nothing motivates better than knowing that in 4 weeks you're going to have another virtual operating session. So I think we've all had a renewed interest in our home layouts to get them running as best as we can. So that's kind of nice. You know, it's nice to see that happen. And I would say it's been pretty good. I've had a lot of fun. All right. So that's the end of the slides that I have. I'm going to pause here and I can answer questions, or I can show more video, or we can do both, whatever we can.
Yeah. Play. We've got a fair number of questions, as you might expect. Let's see, in the car order system, there was a May 2020 event where we talked about that system. Dan Heinel presented that. It's a nice system. I'm using the same thing. Okay, so working through the questions, is the composition of the train the same from layout to layout? It's really based on the car orders. I think you already went through that.
So let me, so the composition of the train will start with a manifest. So in this example, 34E starts in Oakhurst with a particular manifest, but he'll drop off a flat, a tank, you know, three boxes and ore. He'll pick up some cars on his layout. So then he ends up with a manifest that comes out. Now, I think we use the same switch list over and over again, so it might be a little bit redundant between op sessions, but it is, you know, all it takes is just updating this spreadsheet, and then it's a new switch list, a new operation.
So you guys were running more than one at a time, weren't you? So as far as opposing trains and meets, it might happen on a particular layout, but not between layouts, right?
I guess if it's...
It wouldn't really happen in this sort of an arrangement, would it?
Right. You could have... So the AEWRR has the ability to handle meets very nicely because it's got a big enough layout and it has more than one operator. So we try to manage that the meets happen there.
Okay.
If you look on the first class number 20 passenger, and if you look at number 7 passenger, you'll see that the timelines coincide. So there's a meet there on his layout. Yeah. We tried to do it on the timetable on another layout, and it didn't really work.
Right.
Now, for aesthetic purposes, I do park a train on a siding when a train does run through my layout. So the reefer train comes through my layout. So I do sometimes park something there to make it look like a meet, but it's just me running two trains.
Yeah.
You know, really.
let's see. Chuck Hackerinen has just figured out how the train can jump from G scale to HO to N and back using Albert Einstein's special theory of relativity. We'll keep moving. let's see. Somebody's suggestion, looks like the dispatcher could log the time at OS spots to be more like a register of the railroad.
That is correct. It's not on the video here. The last operating session, we actually did that. And rather than highlighting in yellow, we started to log the times.
Yeah.
And
so after the train passes through your layout, you keep on switching cars on your layout.
It's totally up to the operator. I do, because that, you know, that's the fun. And then that's where the car order system will come in. So another layout may say, hey, I dropped these cars off at the interchange track. If I want more activity, I'll go pick them up and switch them. If I don't want more activity, I just leave them there. And I just say, thank you for doing that. Let me know. And so it's pretty flexible.
Right.
Most people keep operating, and we have enough trains running now so that there's, you know, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, We can get 7 to 8 trains on a 2.5 hour session.
Yeah. Let's see. Does a boxcar of grain on a 1940s layout turn into a covered hopper on a modern?
Yes, it does. It's auto magic.
Yeah, it's amazing.
It is. Yeah. If we get to the reefer, you might be able to catch a little bit of how it goes from
ice to I think that's when I connected in on Sunday is. The reefers were coming off one. They were like PFD cars, and all of a sudden they turned into great big white UP reefers on a modern train. So,
yeah, and that's I don't have anything old on my layout, and then so it's that's the best we can do given our circumstances. Yeah. So,
let's see, do small layouts with small trains transfer to larger layouts with longer trains in reverse? So that manifest, it might just be part of the train if it's a big railroad, right?
That's a good question.
So like that train in Oakhurst might have a whole bunch more cars besides one flat, one tank, three box, and one ore. That's kind of the bare minimum.
I don't know. If people have added a whole lot more to that manifest, you totally could, because you could just say this is the block that's going to Colton, or this is the block that came from whatever. So that is some flexibility. My personal feeling is it's kind of nice to try to keep it consistent so that if you're watching it, it looks kind of like, at least there's a theme, from one to the next. But
okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. Is it easy to drop a layout 1 week if someone can't come?
So the answer is yes. In fact, we had Murphy struck on the same day for two layouts. The electrical went down on one layout, and the switch machines went out on another layout. And when you OS, so in this case, I think it was Western Terminal went down. So when the train got to Indian Wells, it just picked right up at San Pedro and just skipped over. And we just colored all that in and pretend that it all happened. Now adding a train in that, you wouldn't be able to add a new layout in that quickly. You'd have to do a little bit of planning, but it's just adding another block to the timetable, and away you go. So.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. I think that's all the questions. And like I said, I think this, I got to watch you guys do this on Sunday. And once you figure out, I hadn't had the introduction, but once I figured out how it was working, I was like, oh, this is cool. That, it made for a fascinating way to participate with each other. I think the camera cars, the Raspberry Pi cars, that's got to be my favorite, especially operating on Bob Rodriguez's layout, where he used to have fixed cameras, but once he went to the camera cars, it's a whole different way to operate. And then you start having to say, wait a minute, I need to know where I'm at. I need some signs, there has to be signs along the way. So, this is the, Indian Wells station, or this is the San Pedro station. You really have to think about it from the little tiny engineer in the cab, their point of view. So it's pretty cool.
And that's one of the reasons why we've added the Zoom operator role. So you heard a little bit of the narration in the video describing where the train's going. Is for someone to see a train, it's really hard to know where you're picking up. And because Zoom will flip around to the active speaker, right? We use a lot of the spotlight, but it's not always easy to jump around and catch it. You have like a second to catch the right camera,
Looks like a bunch of people want to see the reefer video. So,
okay.
those are all the questions. So if you want to just go ahead and play that, I think people would appreciate that. So,
all right. Let me cue it up here. All right, we're going to catch the this will blank out for a second, and you'll we have about 8 or 9 minutes. So I can you'll see it go terminate and come back. If you want me to stop or whatever, just
no, go ahead. You were the only presenter today.
So okay. All right.
Run if people all want right. to drop, they're more than welcome. If you're going to drop, we'll see you in 2 weeks. Watch your email for the next notification. We hit 110 today, so we'll.
Good. All right, here we go.
Hey, who knows what I could see from that old time machine? But there you go again, train traveling. There you go again, train traveling.
Dispatch Western Term.
Western Terminal.
Western Term. Reefer train is at Shanigan.
Say again.
The reefer train has arrived at Shanigan.
Thank you. WT Dispatch.
Western Term Dispatch.
As soon as I can find my piece of paper here. Anyway, I'm off here. Okay, I arrived Alta, transferring to the PHL.
Dispatch copy. That's with the 36 East Reefer.
That would be 38. No, 36. That's correct. And 30 extra 34 will be starting up in about a minute and a half, 2 minutes.
PHL dispatch.
Dispatch, this is PHL.
Reefer train 36 East has arrived at San Pedro.
Okay, we'll be departing there in just a moment. There you go. All right.
This is 43, right? Westbound?
This is 34 East departing San Pedro.
Okay. 34 East departing San Pedro. And that, of course, is a BNSF train. And those are the reefer cars, refrigerated cars. You can see the refrigeration units at the end.
Wooden floor, smell yesterday's whiskey, hear rattling at the door. A railroad man looking for me, I'm scared as I can be. I open my eyes and realize it's just another dream. I hear you, train, are you traveling my way? Won't you let me ride your rails right back to yesterday? Who knows what I could see from that old time machine? But there you go again, train traveling. Yeah, there you go again, train traveling.
PHL to dispatch.
Delayed.
PHL dispatch.
Train 34 East has arrived in Long Beach and is terminating. We'll be changing crews and power, and in probably about 5 minutes, we'll be able to have 43 West depart.
Dispatch copy.
PHL to dispatch.
PHL dispatch.
This is train 43 West, extra reefer, ready to depart Long Beach for San Pedro.
Dispatch copy.
Here is the reefer coming out of Long Beach. From the Pacific Harbor line, it looks like it's going westbound, terminating at Aventura on the Colton layout. Here it is. You'll notice this locomotive is steam.
It's a heritage run, but we decided to make it revenue producing.
Mm.
Well, you know, that's very nice for something that's an esteemed locomotive.
Very esteemed.
I hear you, train, are you traveling my way? Won't you let me ride your rails right back to yesterday? Who knows what I could see from that old time machine? There you go again, train traveling. Yeah, there you go again, train traveling.
PHL, the dispatch.
PHL, dispatch.
This is Reefer Extra 43 West. We have arrived at San Pedro.
All right, copy.
Which I guess means we've actually arrived at Cienega.
Right. AWR dispatch.
So there's an example where we jumped right over the Western Terminal Railroad. So we jumped right to the AEWRR.
Repeat.
AWRR, train number 43 West, reefer train has arrived at Indian Wells.
Thank you. Remember, there's an 8-minute ice for that train. AEWRR to dispatch.
Dispatch.
Train number AEWRR to dispatch, train number 41 is at Mesa Grande.
Do you mean 43?
43, yes. No, 41.
No, 41's at Camp 3.
Or, you're right, 43, I misread. And train number, passenger train number 21 is at Wickenburg. And 36 East is at Mesa Grande.
There you go again, train traveling.
Colton dispatch.
This is Colton.
Train number 43 West, reefer train is at AD track.
Got it. Thank you. This is Colton.
Go ahead, Colton.
Whatever you want.
Train number 43 West. Yes. Has permission to depart the A to D track for Aventura.
Yes.
You want some Panama? Man, I've only seen it on
the dispatch. This is Colton.
Go ahead, Colton.
Train number 2001. Arrives at Aventura and is finished.
What is
this? Train number 43 West Extra.
So there you go. So you can see the a little bit of it. Unfortunately, we're at the mercy when I was putting the video together of trying to find all the right footage, and the Zoom operator, if they don't capture the actual train that's being talked about, you end up with a mismatch. And So you'll see that a few times there, and I apologize because
yeah. it's I think people get the idea that those UP reefers magically turn into something you've got to put ice into, and then they turn into something else.
Yeah.
But it's the idea of that train moving across a whole bunch of railroads without ever them touching. So
yeah, there you go.
Well,
so it keeps us busy, you know, it gives us something to do. And I like it also because it's a way to keep our members involved and something to look forward to. Exactly. So, yeah.
You know, in a world where it's getting safer by the day to do that stuff, but it's still, you know, you still have to be careful, especially with the average model railroader being well into the danger zone in terms of age. It's give it a few months. Once we get vaccines out and widespread vaccinations more available, things will get better for us. But all right. Well, I'm going to stop the sharing here. There were several people who asked if you would be willing to share your slides. If you can send them to me, I'll put them up on the OPSIG website, if that's okay.
I'm happy to do that. This is a link to the video, so obviously the video won't work.
That's fine. I think people just want to see the grid of the paperwork and all that. So they can see the video in the recording. The video should record in the recording, but we do appreciate you presenting. Yeah. And with that, let me do something here. We're gonna stop the recording.